Hello everyone, and welcome back to episode 2 of Monday Podcast. I'm here again with MC Girk.
Hello.
Hello. And today we are going to be discussing the Assassin's Creed game series by Ubisoft. Now, Ryan, what is your first overall opinion on the first series as a whole?
Well, first thing we need to make sure that we do is spoiler warning.
Oh yeah. Got this one every video. Possibly one of spoilers if we discuss story. And once again, it's our own opinion. You have not got to agree. Anything you think we do not necessarily agree with you, or you don't have to agree with us, we can be having critique. But you know, we still hope you enjoy the discussion. We will not just simply go, we hate it, or we don't, or we love it. We will have a discussion. But Ryan, okay, in your opinion, what is your overall opinion of the series as a whole?
I generally quite like it. It can be a bit like, it's a mixed feeling most of the time with me, as I don't like various things such as the Apple of Eden and those sort of things.
All right, so like the supernatural sort of elements.
Supernatural elements, yeah. I am not fond of.
All right. Okay, I personally, it's one of my favorite game series of all time. I've always collected the games. Well, I didn't actually get into Assassin's Creed until I'd say the first one I ever pre-ordered and got on the day it came out was Assassin's Creed 3. So I had purchased 1, 2 Revelations before then to play all through. I saw them in order and I loved them. But okay, do start off with, where we'll start with Assassin's Creed 1.
Yeah, Assassin's Creed 1. I loved it. I loved Assassin's Creed 1.
Yeah, it was absolutely genius.
It was, considering when it that there was nothing else like it at the time.
Hmm.
And that the gameplay was solid, all this.
Yeah.
A lot of people moan about Altair being quite plain. I quite liked him over. He's probably my second favourite assassin in the whole series.
If I talk about Assassin's Creed before I played the other ones, it was an amazing game, because obviously, until Assassin's Creed 2 came out, it completely changed the idea of how it's played. Because the first game was simply you, obviously, at the beginning, you lose your rights as an assassin, and you build your way up again, and, you know, become the assassin once more. And the whole game was literally just, you know, you going down somewhere and then obviously complete the mission, come back, no mission, complete the mission, get, you know, so on and so forth.
And that's really why I liked Altair's story so much, because he had an end goal.
Mm.
Unlike a lot of the assassins who just did things as it went, like, Altair had something to fry for.
Yeah. Cause,
and he had an end goal and eventually reached it.
Now, I thought Altair as a character, obviously, I also love how he went further into his character in Assassin's Creed Revelations. So we saw that in other games. I think it was Assassin's Creed 2 where...
it was.
Yeah, sure. I believe it did that whole scene where Desmond, of course, was going through seeing, like, you know, the Animus in the outside world, and he saw obviously chase a girl, and obviously it didn't quite show he's going to get him pregnant, and obviously we saw a bit more there. But
yeah.
In the first game, also, I quite like the character. I quite like the idea of, like, just, you know, go. It was a lot more, because I remember having to go and speak to like, you know, you had to eavesdrop, you had to either hide in the crowd.
Yeah.
I also liked how you could pose as a priest.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in disguise. I thought it was absolutely genius.
Yeah.
Is there anything else that you'd like to add about Assassin's Creed 1?
Assassin's Creed 1 definitely set the stone for the rest of the series to come for.
Yeah.
And Altair still, to me, is my second favourite assassin in the entire series.
Yeah, and we'll discuss further your favourite assassin when we get there.
Yep.
And, I also quite like the... I think overall in the whole series, the story with Desmond, I thought was brilliant. Because obviously in the first game, it's just simply like, you know, he's just there, he thinks he's, like, sort of, you know, safely there, no, like, you know, he's there as a visitor, and really he's like a prisoner. I like the cliffhanger at the end though, when he starts getting the eagle sense, you know, he starts seeing it in himself, and he sees the writing on the wall.
Compared to the other characters in the series, Desmond is probably the least interesting for me.
Do you think?
Yeah. I like what they did with the story, I just don't find myself getting involved with it. It's kind of difficult when you're going from, like, a game called being Assassin's Creed and being an assassin on a street to then just being a guy walking around the city.
But not necessarily, because in Assassin's Creed 3, you really explore, you really go into, is it Assassin's Creed 3? Yes, it is. Assassin's Creed 3, you really go more into, like, because you actually get levels where you actually... outside Animus and playing as Desmond as an assassin.
Yeah, no, I understand that. But compared to, like, the stories that they put you in the Animus, he doesn't really stand out. That, in fact, in points of like Brotherhood is the best example for it. I even completely forgot that Desmond was even in the game. He was that unimportant to me.
I always want to follow the story. Like, if we went to Assassin's Creed 2 now, which personally is my favorite in the whole series. Ezio Auditore Death Wednesday.
Yep, absolutely. Ezio definitely is my favorite assassin.
My favorite assassin as well. I'm glad that they carried him across 3 games.
Yeah,
he was very good.
Revelations, they were kind of pushing it. Like, now,
I still like Revelations, but it wasn't.
I'm not. That's not what I mean by that. It was a great game, but
yeah,
that is. I think they cut off Ezio's story at the perfect time. So he wasn't in it too, like, it wasn't their main thing.
Well, look, Revelations, I can see what you mean by it was slightly pushing it. Like, that was like, okay, stop there. It was still good. You can stop there. We're done. But yeah, they did it a good time. But in terms of Assassin's Creed 2, I did like, because obviously the story of Ezio, like, obviously he was a lot older when he became Assassin. He was, must have been in his early 20s. And,
yeah,
and
about.
And you could really, you know, like you said before to me, well, while ago, like, when you relate to how, well, obviously we can't personally relate, but some people can, like losing your family and the, what it can do
to you. We can relate in the sense of how much family means.
Yeah.
Because the family that he has that does survive, you can see how much he does for them.
Mm.
Like family are incredibly important to him, and you see that in his character.
Yeah. Now, it's obviously, it's also a little bit beginning when, like, you obviously, your brother trains you how to climb, and then you go and get those feathers for your little brother. And then obviously you do judge for your father. It just really builds up to that moment where you lose your family.
Yeah.
It was really very.
It was definitely a unlike some games. It definitely had, even though we barely saw these characters, it definitely did make us. We definitely were on that field train when they actually died.
Yeah, but also this game was it completely changed how Assassin's Creed game worked. Cause the first one was it was a big step in gaming in general. But this one took it even further. Now, because after Assassin's Creed 2, I don't think the other ones made a bigger jump as these ones, as 1 to 2. Except, obviously, of course, the addition of the ship in Assassin's Creed 3.
Yes, but, I was about to say that.
But other than that, I thought, biggest jump, because even in terms of story, because the first one, it was obviously still a good story, but it was quite, you know, simple. It's really easy to explain. Whereas two, you can go into so much detail into what it was about and how explain it to someone. Obviously, we don't go into too much detail. What was that? Another thing I like Assassin's Creed 2 is also the addition of Leonardo da Vinci.
Yeah.
But I just thought that was so cool to include, because that was you sort of like, wow, they actually include a person from history, and like obviously the only interpretation, of course. It's impossible for the Vinci to have worked with assassins. Well, I don't know. It could have been true.
I very much doubt it.
I very much doubt it, but you never know.
Yeah. No, I did like the inclusion of Leonardo da Vinci. Yeah. It was a bit. It did leave a bad taste in the mouth at some parts in the story.
Yeah.
But more than less, yeah, I think it was a very good choice.
Like, also the addition of the Marcium, like the. It was like a gun. It was like a gun, wasn't it, on the wrist?
One bullet. The hand cannon.
The hand cannon, that was it, yeah. Yeah. But anyway, overall, I thought it was a fantastic game. But going to Assassin's Creed Brotherhood now. Now, you like what Brotherhood is one of your favourites, don't you?
Yes, Brotherhood is my second favourite in the whole series.
That was very good. Now, what is your most favourite part about Brotherhood?
Brotherhood, it was the main point of Brotherhood. The Brotherhood, going out, hiring assassins.
Yeah.
You know, like, you didn't just feel like a lone assassin. You could build up like an army of assassins to back you up.
Yeah, I know.
And I really enjoyed the dynamics of, like,
I liked that. When I first heard about it, I was thinking, okay, are they introducing some sort of like playable co-op?
I thought they would do that as well.
But obviously, I was eventually introduced in the Assassin's Creed Unity. But
yes.
I was hoping for it to be around sooner. But you know, you can't wish for everything. It did come along eventually, but Brotherhood was still good. How you could hire assassins to be with you, and they did continue using that in through Assassin's Creed 3 as well. And
hey, Brotherhood did have multiplayer.
I've never been a huge fan of multiplayer in most of the games.
It was still a step the Assassin's Creed. That's when they first introduced multiplayer.
Again, it's a good multiplayer, like, of course, all the Assassin's Creed games, but it's just not the sort of multiplayer that I personally like.
Yeah, no.
Don't get me wrong. If you like that, it's still good.
They were taking the step towards. making
yeah
it more for more people to
yeah,
play together.
Definitely.
Yeah. And that ended up in the co-op with Unity.
Definitely. Now, also, I believe Brotherhood was also where it went a lot more into depth with the Peace of Eden, didn't it?
Yes, which is what makes it my second and not first.
Well, technically, in Assassin's Creed 2, at the end, that was, of course, when I believe he met, was it Juno, or was it...
I believe it was.
But anyway, it was one of the three gods, because there's one man and two women.
Yeah, the supernatural thing of Assassin's Creed, I've never really enjoyed. I just don't... It works with the universe that it's in.
I think it does in a way. It depends what you like, though, because I quite like... It's interesting, the whole, like, Link, obviously, because... Obviously, when we get into Assassin's Creed, I'll discuss that further. But I did like the sort of link between this, so, like, what the Assassins were there for. And, because Peace of Eden, obviously, but I didn't like also how Ezio just left the staff in the, in the arena.
Mm.
But yeah, like, but obviously then that went further. Each game went further and further, like, even in Assassin's Creed 4, it showed more about, like, the keys, wasn't it, into, Altair's library.
Yeah.
They were quite supernatural. It's weird, it's strange, supernatural objects, and also, like, in Assassin's Creed 1, when we first went... Also, that's when we first... We didn't know what it was, but when Amor Lim had the Apple of Eden.
No. It's a nice... The sci-fi part of Assassin's Creed is well done. It's just...
You don't personally like it.
I do not like it. When I think of Assassin's Creed, I think of being an assassin, not helping some god.
Mm.
It doesn't really... I understand it is a creed, but...
I don't understand what you mean, but...
It's just something that... It's not badly done. That's not the point I'm trying to make. It's just... It leaves a bad taste in my mouth, personally.
I don't understand what you mean, now... It's like, now, Assassin's Creed 3, obviously, of course, went full out into the supernatural, you know, gods and, yeah.
And Assassin's Creed 3 stands out as my least favourite... the entire series.
Yeah, it depends on your opinion. I quite like Assassin's Creed 3 because you don't personally like the character Connor, do you?
I generally think Connor is... He's not a bad character in the gaming world, but compared to every other assassin there's been, he's very poorly done compared to the others, like Altair.
I don't know what you mean, because like I said before about the how... Sorry, spoilers here, about how Connor's mother died.
Yes.
Why, obviously, this was about four sequences, obviously, the first three... Now, but I did like how, in the game, the first four sequences, you're playing as a Templar, obviously, of course, you don't find out until the end of the fourth sequence.
No, that is a nice touch.
When you're playing as Haytham Kenway, of course, that was Connor's father, and also the son, or was it grandson, I'm not sure, of Edward Kenway, who was, of course, in Assassin's Creed 4.
Yes.
Yeah, and... like, I even love the achievement. It was actually called "How to Like Them Apples" when you got to the bit where you finally see a Templar.
Yeah, Connor's mother's scene when she dies, it didn't hit me like Ezio's family. I just didn't care because they didn't give us enough of a relationship between Connor and his mother to make it feel impactful.
It's like carrying Red Dead Redemption. I know some on the game. But there was like about 10 missions where you're on the farm at the end, you know, helping out your family, being with your son, your wife, and
you're just a family man.
You're a family man, and then just to have those like people just shoot you down.
Yeah,
it was heartbreaking for the game. Assuming something free, all you had was literally just one sequence to be you know.
A bare example of what I mean by this, though, would be with The Last of Us.
Oh, yeah?
With Joel's daughter. Oh. I mean, she's only in one level in the game. She's in the first level, and she dies in that level.
Okay.
And it was tear-jerking. Because you could see the relationship between Joel and this girl.
Yeah.
And his daughter. And you know, like... I had no idea she was going to die throughout it, and when she did, it was very impactful.
But also another example would be the Walking Dead, a Telltale game series, the season
yes.
one.
We are spoiling all the games.
Sorry, everyone. I'll put in descriptions, you know, warning. Yeah, yeah. at the end of it, because you had five episodes where you have Clementine and Lee Everett. When Lee Everett is sat there by, you know, the well, and obviously he's talking to Clementine, literally, it was just so, it's tear-jerking.
Yeah.
It was just too much.
Some games have done, like, death scenes incredibly beautifully.
Beautifully, yeah. It's just,
like Oscar level.
Like, to the standard films.
Mm.
Where, like, an animation makes you feel, which is incredible. Anyway, back to Assassin's Creed now. Sorry, we're a bit off track there. We're trying to get our point forward about why the death wasn't as much of a...
We're just comparing it to other reasons, and we're just saying why it didn't stand out.
Yeah. Anyway, also, but with Assassin's Creed 3, I liked the environment. I liked going to, because obviously, Assassin's Creed 1 and 4 were in Africa. Or mm-hmm. was it Israel, wasn't it?
Roundabout.
And Assassin's Creed 2 and Brotherhood were in Italy.
Yep.
And obviously, this, I had this one took a whole new step and went to, like, you know, America. I liked the going to, you know, like the sort of like city areas and like the snow. I thought it was quite a nice place to go. But I also did like the character Achilles.
Yes.
Who you also get to explore further in Assassin's Creed Rogue when he was younger.
Yeah. In regards of Assassin's Creed 3, the only good thing I really thought was in Assassin's Creed 3 was the boat.
Now,
that was enjoyable for me.
Mm. Now, that was, of course, only for a little while, maybe like a sequence or two worth of the whole game.
But, yeah.
Yeah, I did think, I personally didn't quite like the boat. I liked Assassin's Creed because there wasn't a lot of it. There was, you know, a few elements of it, you got to play it. But it was the, and then, of course, it went further in with that in Assassin's Creed 4. Of course, like, I don't want the boat combat, but it's just like, when I play an Assassin's Creed game, I want to be in the city. I want to be, you know, I don't want to be shooting cannons at one other people.
Yes, I understand that, but it was so well done that I was willing to get rid of that thought.
Mm.
Because it was a nice change of pace compared to the other games, and it was another large step that Assassin's Creed took. They'd never done something that big before.
Yeah. Assassin's Creed, like, if we go to go back to the supernatural part.
Yes.
Did you like the link, how obviously the whole game progression to this, linked to the whole idea of 2012? Did you like that or not?
It was alright. The tie was clever. It was very clever how they did it.
Because it was in Assassin's Creed Brotherhood, I think. I believe when we were... You know, so it starts off with Desmond in the van, and then he goes to the villa, which obviously Uncle Mario in Assassin's Creed 2 owns. And I believe he had an eagle sense. In the wall, he saw like a triangle that had the symbols meaning 2012 in it.
Although that was clever. It was clever, again, I did not like it.
Nah.
I don't like the futuristic kind of thing about Assassin's Creed.
Yeah.
It just doesn't feel like an Assassin's Creed game to me.
I understand what you mean, yeah. And what is it? Now, Assassin's Creed 1 through to 3, that had a quite massive story arc outside Animus. Now, of course, sorry, spoilers again, Desmond chooses to place his hands on it's quite a tablet. And obviously choose to kill himself and save the world. But in doing so, releases the god Juno.
Yes.
But now, she's like the god of, like... She's like evil, isn't she?
Yeah, now, I'd say so.
Obviously, it ends there with her saying, now it's my, you know, turn to take a world. Yeah, I'm not quite sure what she said, but it's like her saying, now it's my time to, you know, go into the world. Now, in Assassin's Creed 4, we sort of go into the sort of the world where, like, you're in first person. Now... Do you think this is a new character, not shown us yet, or is it supposed to be personally you?
Assassin's Creed 4?
Yeah, obviously outside the Animus, you went first person.
Yes, I had a pause for a moment because I had no idea what you were on about. No, I didn't generally think that you are an undercover assassin of some sort. I generally like the first person because it made us feel more like we were the protagonist other than some...
But it was just so confusing because Assassin's Creed 3, when it came out, I thought, okay, this must be the last game of the series.
It definitely was confusing.
Because I got
the first person aspect.
I thought I was going like, wait, what is this? It's a whole new game, like this whole pirate thing, like but it's like Animus, like, and also when you first start, it's her walking, going like, okay, this is Abstergo, that's it. And then saying like, we made games such as, you know, Assassin's Liberation. I was like, wait, what's going on? And then I saw there's, you know, the two workers in Assassin's Creed 2. There's the woman with black hair and the guy with glasses.
I
remember seeing them in the hallway. I was like, wait, what's that? Wait, what?
No, I definitely do think that it is a great addition myself. Mm. It definitely added a new idea of the Assassin's Creed games.
Yeah.
But, and this is where me and you both part ways in opinions on this Assassin's Creed universe.
Yep.
I personally loved Black Flag. To me, it is my favourite Assassin's Creed game.
Now, in my opinion, I like it, but it's one of my least favourites.
Only reason I like it so much is because I like the boat combat. Mm. The boat combat is either make or break.
I understand that it's a fun game in its own right. Like, it's a good pirate game, but I just don't think it's an Assassin's Creed game.
Yes, but, like, people say that about me, but, like, why I like it, it's not an Assassin's Creed game. And the main point I say back is, yes, but I don't like the sci-fi, and Black Flag had very little amount of sci-fi.
Yeah, I understand what you mean there, but like, it's like, it's just, I just thought it took too big of a jump to something else.
Yes, I understand that.
I did like the addition of, like, you know, Blackbeard, and then what's like, I feel it was like, you know, B, the kid, wasn't it?
Yes.
And for the whole game, I was sitting there going, that's a girl. And that bit though,
I wasn't that smart. I didn't get that
because I was going, wait a minute. And then when we laughed, was that moment when she, you know, she got a bit of blood, put on her lips. I was like, what the hell, blood lipstick?
Yeah. No, I wasn't that clever. I didn't get that bit.
As soon as I saw him, you know, I was like, hang on.
Yeah.
I just saw it. I was going, that's
him. Big quotation marks.
Yeah, like, big quotation mark him, yeah. But yeah, like, okay, it was a good game, but just not personally my favourite. Of course, it's one of your favourites.
One of my favourites. It felt like, it felt right, in a way. It felt like, I was watching and thinking, this is a great step that they're taking. The boat combat, I understand, like, how some people don't like it. I personally thought it was the best kind of ship combat I've ever seen in a game.
Yeah. What was it? If you remember, because after this, they made Assassin's Creed Unity. Now, Unity took a step backwards after that. Well, not quite backwards, because obviously they introduced the co-op, but in terms of what Assassin's Creed was, they went back to the no ships, purely in the city. I did like the setting of France, though.
Despite the fact that there was no ships, I generally still liked Unity. The only problem I had with Unity was the condition it first was released in.
I'll say mean, because obviously we'll mention obviously, of course.
But nowadays,
yeah,
it's a great game.
I think it is a brilliant game. Like, I thought, I believe it's called Arno, if
yes,
I'm not mistaken.
Arno.
Very clever. So I like how at the beginning they introduced the obviously him as a child, and actually the first intro was obviously showing the sword.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh, this is clever. And then obviously at the end of it, you find the sword again. And obviously you get the keeper, which is brilliant. Fuck a god. And but I did like how it showed obviously Arno as a child and showing his father dying.
Yeah, it just allows you to feel more for his character,
exactly.
His father dying.
And then I thought the character, because he's quite a likable character, actually. He's like Edward. He's quite, you know, sleazy and like, you know.
Yeah, Edward definitely was an incredibly likable character.
Yeah.
Even though he was a bit of an arsehole to the assassins.
Yeah.
He was still likable because he never gave you a reason to hate him.
Yeah. So,
at the same time, he never gave you a reason to really like him.
Save Arno, really. I quite like the story, like how obviously I always like that his sort of girlfriend, you know what I mean? Like her as well.
Yeah.
And then I think one of my favourite missions are, I don't know why, it had to be the bit where she was in like the hot air balloon. He was chasing. I thought it was brilliant. Like,
there are a lot of brilliant things in Unity.
Yeah,
but there are still some things that I do not agree with, and well, not agree with, more dislike.
Such as?
The time travelling.
Yeah.
I can understand where they were trying to go with it. I personally didn't like it.
Mm. Now,
I didn't think it... Again, with the sci-fi, I didn't think it went well in the universe that Assassin's Creed is.
But also, to the unity, I weren't a massive fan of the leveling up system they had.
I had no real opinion on it. It wasn't enough to annoy me.
It annoyed me because obviously you had to... before, you just play the campaign, go for it, you're fine. Obviously, it's time before they introduced that a bit more, because obviously you had to have a certain standard of ship to go forward. Yeah. But in this one, they really introduced the leveling system.
Yeah. I can definitely see it. The best way to probably see it is it's... A lot of people rush through the Assassin's Creed game and don't fully take in everything. I guess that's a way to kind of... Like, you know, slow down. You're meant to be enjoying this. Take everything in. Mm.
But with me...
And if that's what they were going for, then it was very well done.
But like with me, it's like I still can't achieve the 5 diamond level.
I can't do it.
I got 5 diamonds. I can't get the gold 5 diamonds. That's it.
Yeah.
That's what's nice, yeah. Because it is quite hard to achieve. And now...
It definitely is difficult to achieve.
What do you also think of the... the co-op in the game.
The co-op, it's well done. Mm. Like, it's a nice addition. It could have been put in a better...
It still doesn't change
the fact for how broken the game was, which I am still quite salty about, because it was... To me, it was unacceptable how the game came out. No, I understand why.
If you look at Batman Arkham Knight PC, that's unacceptable.
Yeah. Lately, a lot of games have been coming out in an unacceptable
Arkham Knight
state.
Is an absolutely beautiful game, but it's just a shame for those who can't play it.
Yes, we will talk about the Batman series.
Because I have it on Xbox One, and not gonna lie, it's one of the fun games I've ever played. It's amazing, but it's just like, I see what it means by it's bad that it was broken. For PC players, mainly. Consoles, so far, I've not seen a bug.
With considering how expensive games can be nowadays...
Yeah.
You should expect, at the least,
like top quality,
for the game to function
the way
that it was advertised.
Something about how Unity works, it was buggy, but you still play it.
Once the game was fixed, and all those problems were addressed, it was a great game.
Unity.
Yes, it was a great game when the problems were addressed and fixed.
Definitely. Of course, it got away with the whole floating faces thing and all that. No, floating eyeballs, sorry. Yeah.
Yes.
Eyeballs. Yeah, and...
The floating faces.
Yeah.
The funny part was is that they lacked everything but a face.
Yeah. Now, if we've gone to last game, and last, I believe, is the 8th game in the series. Now, one, you've got...
Yes.
You're in place one, have you?
Which one is it? Remind me?
Assassin's Creed Rogue.
Rogue. I have heard things from Rogue.
Now, this one, of course, was a old-gen only. Well, kind of PC later. I don't understand why it was old-gen only. I guess they just did. It's like a little, you know, last thing for the old-gen players. But, yes, I thought it was quite a very interesting story. This one went back to the ship combat, though, of course, in the ice regions, where you can actually go through ice, you know, go in the North Atlantic,
Refresh my memory. Rogue is the one which you play with a Templar.
You play as a Templar.
Yes, as a Templar.
As Templar. But this is an Irish character. I can't remember his name. I'm playing it well. And,
one thing that I did... My only main concern when I heard about Rogue was the fact of what happens if I like the Templar side more than
now,
the Assassin.
The thing is, I actually did like Templars after this because
yes, I did as well. I agree.
Because obviously, I told you about the story, didn't I?
Yes.
And
I
won't spoil. I won't spoil.
Very unlikely I was ever going to get.
I won't spoil too much, but basically, this character. I'm really sorry I forgot his name. The character he's an assassin, you play with the assassins, and then he realizes personally that the assassins he believes are incorrect, because he goes to a city, removes one of these let's call it roots, like these artifacts which actually hold up the parts of the earth that hold the earth up, and he was told to remove it and grab it from the assassins, and he realized it destroyed the city.
Yeah.
And obviously he realized you people are, like he said, the assassins, you people are mad, you want me to remove these. And then again, and then obviously he finds Hayfam Kenway.
Yes.
And also joins Templars. I won't go any further there. But the point is, he joins the side. I actually agreed with this character.
His decision, as yeah. as did I, it was definitely the more humane decision to make.
Now, like, because I actually rooted for the Templars after this. It was just so strange to actually do that.
To be siding with the people that you only saw as an enemy.
Yeah, because
until that point.
Because for the seven games, or eight games, you call it Liberation.
Yeah.
I mean, rooted for the Assassins.
Yeah.
It's just such a strange...
And then now Rogue came out and we're questioning everything we believed in.
Question the creed.
Yes.
It's just strange, isn't it?
It was a nice touch they added to give both sides of the battle.
Definitely.
And it definitely stands out in a way that most games don't.
Yeah.
As if you take... The best example would be Call of Duty, where it's just... Kill these guys. Why? Because they're the bad people. It gives you a reason to either agree or disagree with each side.
Definitely.
And it has that depth that not every game can say it has.
Yeah. Right. Okay, I think we've gone through every game, haven't we?
Yeah. For this part, anyway.
Yeah, I think if we go through elements of the game, like, do you like, let's go through, like, such, like, camouflage and gameplay elements of the game. What do you think, like?
The camouflage, well, none to say the least. The actual assassin part of the Assassin's Creed game is phenomenally done.
Brilliantly done. Like, obviously, and for the games, they progress further because for the games, you always hide in haystacks and hide in crowds.
But then there's the unrealistic part about the leap of faith.
Don't go there. Yeah. Like, just die from no matter what height and survive in the hay, but let's just not go there.
I like it, but at the same time, you just look at it, this is a bit silly.
Yeah.
Let's be real. And, this is a bit ridiculous.
But I like how, obviously, then they added in, they're going to hide in bushes. Then, as I thought, I was a bit like, they added in the half camouflage, didn't they?
Yes.
Where you could hide in, fields of,
crops. You weren't invincible, like just tall grass and large bushes.
Yeah.
Like, you weren't completely camouflaged, but you were enough so they wouldn't spot you instantly.
Like, they were going more into the
I thought that was a great addition.
Good addition, yeah.
It just gives you, plus with camouflage such as hay barrels, you cannot move inside them mechanic allowed you to move around, which made stealth parts of the game so much easier.
Definitely. Now, what about the overall game's graphics? Like, let's go through each game. Like, would you say one, for its time, had good graphics as well?
One, for me, for its time, still has some of the best graphics of its time.
Yeah, because that's where alone the graphics did improve further and further. But I thought it was strange, though. Again, Rogue was a strange one. And obviously, of course, if you could liberate, we don't want to discuss Liberation, because obviously that was a PS Vita game, which then turned to Liberation HD on consoles and PC.
But to be fair, on games such as Liberation, it is on a system that doesn't have as much power.
Yeah.
So it cannot take as much, which it has a reason to not be as graphically pleasing as other games.
But if we go for the series, obviously, the game improves as go along, but in Unity, obviously, that obviously went through a further step. Because 3 to 4 to Unity, they kept changing engines. But obviously, Rogue was after Unity, but it came out on the same day of launch. But Rogue kept the 4 engine. It's a bit strange that they would go from Unity to Rogue. Because obviously, Rogue had to come after. Because obviously, again, sorry if it's a spoiler, but it's quite a bit more tough now if you don't hear it. The Templar you play as actually goes and kills Arno's father in France.
Yeah.
That was the big link. Yeah.
I think the main reason Rogue used the Assassin's Creed 4 engine...
It's probably ship combat.
That's what I was going to say. The ship combat, would just make it a better engine to run off because the ship combat is already there.
Because they know it works.
They know it can function. They've seen it work.
Yeah. Okay.
So it would be the better option.
Okay, so overall, if we were to give the overall series a rating, what would you personally give Gear Ryan out of 10?
A series out of 10? I would give the Assassin's Creed series an 8.
I'll give it a 9.
It's a great series.
Yeah.
But, as I've said before, the sci-fi kind of kills it for me.
Now, it's my favourite games of all time, but it has its moments where you sort of go like, it could have been
better.
It
is one of my favourite game series of all time as well. But the entire sci-fi thing ruins that for me.
Yeah,
and just makes it literally unenjoyable in some points.
It does feel free to put a pen on what you like.
It definitely does.
For me, I like that sort of stuff, so I didn't mind it as such.
Yes, but for me, I was more of a... When you play Assassin's Creed, that's the problem with Assassin's Creed. It's because they've done the combat so well.
Yeah.
You feel like you're in that time. And when they all of a sudden throw in sci-fi, it kind of kills the mood that you've been put in.
Yeah.
Because of the combat. So the combat, although it being Assassin's Creed's strong points, is also where it falls short on its other features.
Yeah, definitely. Right. Okay, I think that's enough Assassin's Creed discussion for today.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry. Right, everyone. I hope you enjoyed today's podcast Monday. We'll hopefully see you next Monday with a new podcast. And hopefully, we'll do a Halo next week.
Yes.
But Bungie's one only. We're going to be discussing Halo 1 through to our survival game Reach the Maze.
Yes.
And we'll have another podcast including Halo 4, Wars, and discussing the new Guardians game of what we've seen so far.
Yes.
Well, everyone, we'll see you in the next podcast. Goodbye.
Bye.